نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم، أما بعد، فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم: أكثروا ذكر هاذم اللذات الموت، أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم: رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. سبحانك لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم انفعنا بما علمتنا وعلمنا ما ينفعنا. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي: يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه وأتباعه وأزواجه وذرياته. Our stay in this world is temporary, and sooner or later each and every one of us will have to return to our permanent abode in the hereafter. Imam Ghazali rahimahullah ta'ala states: if the space between this earth and the heavens was filled with pebbles or filled with sand, and if a single pebble was removed after every 1,000 years, so just think for a while the number of pebbles that this space would be able to encompass and take. Innumerable. And Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi alayhi states that out of these innumerable pebbles, a pebble is removed after every 1,000 years. Only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how long it will take before all these pebbles are removed. Millions, billions, trillions of years. Unimaginable, the number. Imam Ghazali rahmatullahi alayhi states that a time will come when all these pebbles will be removed, but the life hereafter will not come to an end. So, if we compare the life of this world, which consists of a few years, 60 years, 70 years, 80 years, 100 years, over 100 years the most. If we compare the life of this world with the life of the hereafter, it is incomparable. And if the life of this world is incomparable with the life hereafter, because the life of this world is very little and the life hereafter is everlasting, then even if a person was granted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all the enjoyments that a person can imagine in this world for 70 years, 60 years, 50 years, 80 years, 100 years, in comparison to the life hereafter, he would have acquired no enjoyment, because it is not even a drop in the ocean. It is for this reason Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to the messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam: O my messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam tell the people, Qul, mata'ud dunya qaleel, the benefits of this world, the enjoyments of this world are very little. Very little compared to the enjoyments in the hereafter. Wal akhiratu khayrun, and the akhirat is much, much better. But not for everybody. The akhirat is much, much better for those people who will find enjoyment in the hereafter. For those people who are thrown in the fire of hell, there will be no enjoyment for them in the hereafter. So for them, this worldly life is better than the hereafter. But for those people who will find enjoyment in the hereafter is not only better, it is much, much better than this world. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam has said, Ad-dunya sijnul mu'min wa jannatul kafir. This world is a prison for the believer and a paradise, a heaven, a jannat for the non-believer. One of the interpretations of this hadith is that even if a believer was to acquire every type of enjoyment in this world, and if he was to see no grief in this world, despite seeing no grief, despite seeing every enjoyment in this world, compared to what he is going to receive in the hereafter, this world is still a prison for him. It is like a prison for him. And a non-believer, if he was to see nothing in this grief, in this world but grief, grief upon grief, grief upon grief, and if he was not to see any comfort or any enjoyment or any luxury whatsoever in this world, despite him seeing and experiencing no luxury, no enjoyment in this world, despite him experiencing grief over grief during his whole life, compared to the punishments that he is going to face and experience and endure in the fire of Jahannam, this world will still be a sort of paradise for him. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to say to the people that mata'ud dunya qaleel, the benefits and the enjoyments of this world are very little. For whom? For those people who will find enjoyment in the hereafter. Because compared to the enjoyments of the hereafter, the enjoyments of this world are very, very little. Wal akhiratu khayrun, and akhirat is much, much better. Akhirat is far more better. But for whom? For those people who will find enjoyment in the hereafter. And who will find enjoyment in the hereafter? Those people who suppress their desires and adopt taqwa. وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرُ لِمَنِ اتَّقَى. Akhirat is far, far better. Akhirat is far more better, much, much better for those people who suppress their desires, for those people who do not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for those people who adopt taqwa, for those people who suppress their desires for the desire and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, akhirat is much, much better for those people who adopt taqwa, for those people who suppress desires. From this we learn that the only way to become successful in the hereafter and acquire the bliss of Jannah is by adopting taqwa. And a person will only be able to adopt taqwa if he is able to suppress his desires. If a person is able to suppress his unlawful desires, control his desires, then he will be able to adopt taqwa. And if he is able to adopt taqwa, that means he will be able to make preparations for the life hereafter. So only that person will be able to adopt taqwa, only that person will be able to make preparations for the life hereafter who is able to suppress his desires. One who suppresses his desires will be able to adopt taqwa, will be able to make preparations for the life hereafter. And one who is able to make preparations for the life hereafter, because the life hereafter is far more better than this world, this person, in the eyes of Allah and His Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, will be called a clever person. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, Al-Qayyisu man dana nafsahu wa amila lima ba'd al-maut. The clever one is he who controls his nafs, who controls his base desires, who suppresses his unlawful desires, and by suppressing his unlawful desires, he makes preparation for the life hereafter by adopting taqwa. Now, the key question, because we have learned that in order to become successful in the hereafter, which is far more better than this world, one has to be a muttaqi. And in order to become a muttaqi, one has to do good things. He has to abstain from those things which displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And in order to do that, one has to suppress his unlawful desires. So the key question is, how can we make this task easy? To suppress our unlawful desires. What is the method? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has said, remembrance of death. Akthiru dhikra hadhimi ladzat. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, frequently remember the breaker of your desires. In abundance, remember that thing which crushes your desires. And what is that thing? Al-Maut. Now the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam is instructing his followers to frequently remember death. He is instructing his followers to remember death in abundance, not to push it aside. If the thought of death comes, and if it creates some kind of fear in your heart, then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does not teach us to put this fear aside, put this remembrance of death aside and try to forget death. No, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is encouraging and emphasizing that you must remember death frequently, you must remember death in abundance, because it is only death that will crush your desires, that will bring your unlawful desires under control. It is for this reason, when asked by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi, by the Sahaba ikram ridwanullahi ta'ala alayhi majma'in, man akiyasun nas wa man ahwatun nas, who is the most clever person and who is the most precocious person who safeguards all his interests? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, aksaruhum zikran lil maut wa isti'dadan lil maut. Those people who remember death in abundance, and when they remember death in abundance, then they become those people who prepare for death in abundance. Those people who continually remember death will continually prepare for that moment. Aksarum zikra lil maut wa istidadan lil maut. Ulaika kiya sunnas. These are the clever people. Zahabu bi sharafi dunya wa bi karamati al akhirah. Zahabu bi sharafi dunya. They have gone away with the nobility of this world. Wa karamati al akhirah, and the honor of the hereafter. So those people who remember death frequently will be able to control their desires, And those people who are able to control their desires, they will be able to make preparations for the life after death. They will be able to adopt taqwa. They will be able to do those things which bring the pleasure of the Almighty. And if they are able to acquire the pleasure of the Almighty, then they will become successful in the life hereafter. And if they are able to become successful in the life hereafter, then they are the most clever of the people. So remembering death, daily each person should try to take out some time to remember death. Anything between 5 minutes to 15 minutes. And if due to negligence or if due to a very busy schedule, a person is unable to take out 5 to 15 minutes on a daily basis, then each person should take out 15 minutes per week at least. And the easiest method is to fix the day and fix the time. Fix the day and fix the time. Every Thursday before going to sleep I will do this. Every Friday before going to sleep I will do this. Or every Monday before going to sleep I will do this. Remember death. Go into seclusion. Find yourself a place of solitude where there is no one else, where there is no disturbance. In your bedroom, in a corner of a house, during the night when it is dark, and sit down and think about your departure from this world. Convince yourself that sooner or later a day is going to come when you will have to depart. And it will be sooner rather than later. Convince yourself. It is the trick of shaitan and nafs that they continue to defer this thought in our minds. No, I'm still young and healthy. Death will come and death will come any time and it can come any time. But I think in my case, I'm still young. I'm still healthy. I believe that it can come to healthy people as well. It is my aqidah, it is my belief, it is experience that it can strike any time. But I think subconsciously we don't accept that this is going to happen to me. Because if we did accept, we would not commit sins. We would not disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Only that person will live a life of negligence who believes very firmly that he is not going to die soon. Or at least he is not going to die whilst he is committing this sin. So we need to convince ourselves that sooner or later, and it is sooner rather than later, death is going to knock on our door. And it may come suddenly. It may come suddenly, so we need to ask ourselves this question every day or at least once a week, that have I made preparations for that moment? Have I made preparations for that moment? What if I was to depart now? Ask yourself this question. I am committing this sin. I committed this sin yesterday. I committed this sin today. I have committed 10 sins today. And I still haven't repented. Since Ramadan, I have been committing this particular sin and I still haven't repented. Watching films, listening to music, fulfilling desires through unlawful means, looking at non-mahram ladies, masturbation, adultery, fornication, drugs, alcohol, so many vices. I am indulging in these vices on a continual basis without repenting. What if death strikes on my door at this very moment? Am I in a position to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or not? My friends, sit down in solitude during the darkness of the night once a week and ask yourself these questions, and I assure you, you will definitely repent there and then. Because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam promises, أَكْثِرُ ذِكْرَ هَذِمِ اللَّذَّادِ الْمَوْتِ. Those people who remember death frequently, it breaks the desires. It creates the fear in the heart. And it is not a superficial fear. It is a real fear. We are going to go from this world sooner or later. And as I said, sooner rather than later. And when we depart from this world, when Malakul Maut arrives to extract our soul, only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows in what condition we will be. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us all safety. What if Malakul Maut arrives when we are committing sins? When we are disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Think for a moment, if we have the habit of unlawfully gazing at non-mahram ladies and deriving pleasure from that, what if Malakul Maut was to arrive during that moment when we are deriving pleasure out of gazing at non-mahram ladies? And if he was to extract our soul during that moment. What if Malakul Maut was to extract our soul whilst watching film and enjoying ourselves, whilst listening to music and enjoying ourselves? How will we face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, يُبْعَثُ كُلُّ عَبْدٍ عَلَى مَا مَاتَ عَلَيْهِ. Every person will be resurrected in the state that he has died in. If a person died watching film, he will be resurrected and brought in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whilst watching film. If a person died whilst committing adultery, fornication, he will be brought to the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala whilst in that action. If a person died mixing with a non-mahram in an unlawful way, talking to a non-mahram, deriving pleasure from that conversation, then the person will be resurrected in that same condition. So we need to ask ourselves all these questions, just sitting there in the darkness, I could die any time, I could die now. What if I die now? Am I ready to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If I die now, did I perform today's Fajr Salat? Have I made Qadha? Did I perform Zohar Salat today? Have I made Qadha? Did I perform Maghrib Salat today? Have I made Qadha? Have I repented? Am I in a position to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and answer Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that, oh Allah, yes, I did make these mistakes today, but I have sincerely repented, you know that. Before I came, I repented. I did not perform Fajr, I did not perform Dhuhr, I did not perform Asr, I did not perform Maghrib, but after Maghrib, I performed Qadha of all these four Salat, and I said to you that, oh Allah, forgive me, I will not miss any Salat anymore, and I had a firm resolution to go for Isha Salat. You are aware of that, you are the knower of the intentions. Are we in a position to say that? Think, my friends, how many sins we commit. Ask yourselves that if I am committing only 10 sins during the day, 10 sins, there are so many sins we commit which go unnoticed. If we are studying in a university, if we are studying in a college, just walking on the streets, maybe we are committing the sin of gazing at non-mahrams 10 times a day. Maybe more than 10 times a day. But let us take this figure, the figure of 10, being the maximum sins that we commit in 24 hours. All sins put together, only 10. In 30 days, how many sins do we commit? 300. And if we commit 300 sins in 1 month, then in 12 months, 3,600 sins we commit. If we don't repent, if we don't turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how will we face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and how will we give account for these heaps of sins that we are committing on a daily basis? And I am only saying that we are committing 10 days per sin, assuming if we are committing 10 days per sin, 10 sins per day. If we are committing 10 sins per day, then it's 3,600 in a whole year. And if we are committing more than that, one very pious person person used to advise his students that keep in one pocket of your jubba or one pocket of your coat some grains of rice or wheat and keep the other pocket empty and monitor yourself. Whenever you make a mistake, remove one grain from that pocket and put it in the empty pocket. And after Isha, before retiring to bed, count these grains so you know how many sins you have committed. And then remember death. Ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. Make tawbah and make a firm resolution that tomorrow I will not commit these sins, and then do the same again so you are able to assess your progress on a daily basis. Thereafter, think to yourself that I am dying now. I am on my deathbed. Imagine, go into the world of imagination. I am on my deathbed. I am dying now. All I have in front of me are my good deeds and my bad deeds. The doctors are coming and going, but unable to help me. My relatives, my friends, my wealth, nothing is being able to help me and save me from this tunnel of death. And finally I have departed. I have departed, and because of my sinful life, the Malakul Maut has come with angels who will take me to the fire of Jahannam, who will not take me to Illiyin, where the souls of the people of paradise are taken. They are taking me to Sijjin, where the souls of the people of Jahannam are taken. They are taking me. Now people are taking off my clothes, they are bathing me, they are shrouding me, they have put me in a coffin. They are taking me to the Qabristan. They are performing my janaza salat. Now they are lowering me in the grave. They are covering my grave. I am in the darkness of the grave. Imagine. And then ask yourself a question that when you are placed in the grave, when you are placed in the grave, is my grave going to be spacious? Or is my grave going to be tight? Is it going to be a very tight grave, or is it going to be a spacious grave? Is my grave going to become a garden from the gardens of paradise, or is it going to become a ditch from the ditches of hell? Is my grave going to be full of light, full of nur, or is my grave going to be full of darkness? Do I have enough amal and enough deeds to save me from the scorpions and the snakes in the grave? To save me from the fire in the grave? Do I have enough amal that they will open the window leading to the Jannah for me? Or am I only going with evil deeds which will open the window which will lead to Jahannam? And from where warm and hot air full of smoke will come continually in my grave? When Munkar Nakir come to ask me questions, Mar Rabbuka, Ma Deenuka, Ma Taqulu Fi Hadha Rajul, will I be able to answer those questions? Will they treat me with kindness, with leniency, because I am a good person and I have been a muttaqi? Or will they question me harshly? Will they give me a rough treatment because of my evil deeds? Ask these questions. On the day of Qiyamah, when I am resurrected, what will happen to me? Will I be granted shade under the mercy of the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Or will I be standing in scorching heat? When I stand in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reckon me with a light reckoning, or will Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala treat me very harshly when taking my account? Upon being reckoned with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give me my book of deeds in my right hand, or will He give me my book of deeds in my left hand? When I am asked to cross the Sirat, the bridge of Sirat, do I have enough good amal that I will be able to cross the bridge of Sirat in the speed of lightning, or do I have heaps of evils on my shoulders which will land me in the fire of Jahannam? Ask these questions. Remember death and all the stations that are to come after death. Death can strike any time. What will happen at the time of death? How will people treat me after I am dead? After the performance of Janaza Salat, after they lay me in my grave, what will happen to me? What will happen to me when I am resurrected on the day of Qiyamah? What will happen to me at the time of reckoning? What will happen to me when I am crossing the bridge of Sirat? What if I am doomed to go in the fire of Jahannam? What will happen to me? Ask these questions. My friends, even once a week, if you are able to do this for 15 minutes, cry, weep after this meditation and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness and make a firm resolution. Firm resolution. Tell yourself that these paltry enjoyments, temporary enjoyments for a few moments will land me in the eternal destruction. And repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Al-Qayyisu man dana nafsahu wa amila lima ba'da al-maut. The clever one is he who controls his desires. And by controlling his desires, he is able to make preparation for the life hereafter. And in order to control the desires, we need to remember death. Let me conclude with an incident of the great Tabi'i, Ubayd ibn Umair, rahimahullah ta'ala. Ubayd ibn Umair, rahimahullah ta'ala, was a very great Tabi'i and a very pious personality in Makkah Mukarramah. He was a very eloquent person also. And due to his piety, his eloquence, his knowledge, the great Sahabi Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu ta'ala anuhuma also used to pay him visits. During his time, there lived in Makkah Mukarramah a very, very beautiful woman. Very beautiful woman, the most beautiful woman in Arabia at that time. One day, she was sat with her husband when she suddenly got up from her place, and she looked at her beauty in the mirror and she made this remark in front of her husband that, is there anybody who will be able to control himself when he sees my beauty in this world? So the husband said, yes, there is one person who will be able to control himself, and that is Ubayd ibn Umair, rahimahullah ta'ala, because the husband was fully aware of the pious people in Makkah Mukarramah. He said, yes, there is one person who will be able to suppress his desire, who will be able to control himself, and that is Ubayd ibn Umair. So she smiled, and she said, it is not possible. The beauty that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted me, no man will be able to suppress his desire when his gaze falls on my beauty, and especially when I invite him towards evil. If you give me permission, I will prove it to you. So the husband said, okay, I give you permission. But I am telling you, I am 100% sure you will not be able to seduce Ubayd ibn Umair rahimahullah ta'ala. So she said, okay, fine. Time will tell. One day it so happened that she was in Haram Sharif and she saw Ubayd ibn Umair rahimahullah ta'ala. And it was not a rush hour. So she went near Ubayd ibn Umar rahimahullah ta'ala in the Haram Sharif and she said, I need to consult you on a Shari'i matter. Can I speak to you? So Ubayd ibn Umar rahimahullah ta'ala said, yes, let's move on one side because we will be obstructing people. Let's move on one side. So she said, I am a woman, I am a bit shy. Please come in the corner here. And he took Ubayd ibn Umar rahimahullah ta'ala in the Haram Sharif in a very secluded corner. And as soon as she and Ubayd ibn Umar rahimahullah ta'ala stood face to face, she removed her veil. She lifted her veil up. And Ubayd ibn Umar rahimahullah ta'ala, as soon as his gaze fell on this woman's beauty, he turned his face away and he said, Ittaqillaha ya amatallah. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Oh, the servant of Allah. What are you doing? Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is watching you and me. So she said, I have fallen in love with you. I am deeply in love with you. And I want to fulfill my desire with you. So Ubayd ibn Umar rahimahullah ta'ala had full control over himself, alhamdulillah. Because he was a muttaqi. His heart was continually in the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The mind was all the time connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is watching me. Allah has control over me. And death could take me any time. He had full control. And he had so much control that he desired at that moment to call this lady towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he said, I can seriously think about your invitation if you answer a few questions correctly. I would like to ask you certain questions. If you answer them correctly, then I can seriously think about your proposal. So she said, okay, go ahead. She became happy that yes, my trying to lure him is working. So the first question Ubayd ibn Umar rahimahullah ta'ala asked was, that if Malakul Maut was to arrive at this precise moment to extract your soul, will you still continue with the same intention? What do we learn from this? What do we learn from this incident? Ubayd ibn Umar rahimahullah ta'ala, a great tabi'i, a great wali of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is teaching us through these questions that in order to suppress your desires, in order to curb your nafs from committing disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you must begin to ask these questions which remind you of the hereafter and death. So she said, no, I cannot even imagine to commit this sin if Malakul Maut was here extracting my soul. So he said, your answer is correct. Your answer is correct. He said, question number two. If I and you were standing in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah for reckoning, and you and I were not aware whether the book of deed will be placed in the right hand or the book of deed will be placed in the left hand, will you still wish to commit this sin? She said, no, definitely not. I would not even think about it. So he said, the answer is correct. He said, third question. If I and you were near the pool Sirat, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded you to walk on the bridge of Sirat, at that time would you even think of committing this sin? She said, no, definitely not. Ubayd ibn Umar rahimahullah ta'ala said, the answer is correct. He asked three questions reminding her of death. Reminding her of death. Reminding her of the reckoning on the day of Qiyamah. Reminding her of the fact that she will have to cross the Sirat. That is all he did. He reminded her of death. And suddenly the whole life of this woman changed. The whole life changed. And she returned home with a very changed face. And she became so devoted to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and she became so simple in her life that her husband, who used to enjoy her company and who used to enjoy her beauty used to say that Ubayd ibn Umair has snatched away my luxury in this world. That means Ubayd ibn Umair is the one who has transformed my wife into a very pious lady. Just three questions reminding her of death and the stations after death, and this changed her life. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Aktharu zikra hadimi ladzat al-maut." Remember that item, remember that thing which crushes your desires. That means which controls your nafs, and that is al-maut. And in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "Wa amma man khafa maqama rabbihi." One who fears standing in the court of his Rabb, وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ, and one who controls his desires, his base desires. That means the one who will continue to remind him that a day is going to come when you will have to stand in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How will you show your face with all these evils, with all this filth? وَنَهَا النَّفْسَ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ, then he will be able to control his desire. And once he is able to control his desire, he will only do good. And if he only does good, فَإِنَّ الْجَنَّةَ هِيَ الْمَأْوَىٰ, then Jannah is his abode. So frequently remember death at least once a week. Once a week. Daily is best. That is the best. And every day take out 10-15 minutes and ask yourself these questions. If you cannot take out 10-15 minutes on a daily basis, then on a daily basis, ask a few general questions for 5 minutes and once a week for 15 minutes. And if you are still unable to do that, then at least once a week for 15 minutes sit down and remember death. And also try to read now and then the book written by Shaykhul Hadith, Maulana Muhammad Zakariya Sahib, Rahmatullahi Alayhi, The Remembrance of Death. Once we remember death, my friends, we will be able to control and suppress our nafs. And once we are able to do that, we will be able to do good deeds, we will be able to adopt taqwa. And once we have taqwa, وَالْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لِّمَنِ اتَّقَىٰ, Akhirah is best, far, far better than this world for those people who adopt taqwa. وَآخِرُ دَعْوَانَا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدُ وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والصلاة والسلام على رسوله سيدنا ومولانا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا اغفر لنا وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. يا مصرف القلوب صرف قلوبنا على طاعتك, يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك. اللهم احفظنا من كل بلاء الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة. اللهم آت نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها, أنت وليها ومولاها. اللهم اشف مرضانا وارحم موتانا, اللهم اشف مرضانا وارحم موتانا, اللهم اشف مرضانا وارحم موتانا. يا حي يا قيوم برحمتك نستغيث, نستغفرك ربنا ونسألك التوبة, وأصلح لنا شأننا كله, ولا تكلنا إلى أنفسنا طرفة عين, ولا تنزع منا صالح ما آتيتنا. اللهم إنا نسألك من خير ما سألك منه نبيك سيدنا محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم, ونعوذ بك من شر ما استعاذ منه نبيك محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم. وأنت المستعان وعليك البلاغ, ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا ولأساتذتنا ولمشايخنا ولأهلينا ولمن له حق علينا ولمن أوصانا بالدعاء, ولجميع المؤمنين والمؤمنات والمسلمين والمسلمات الأحياء منهم والأموات, إنك سميع قريب مجيب الدعوات. وصلى الله على خير خلقه سيدنا ومولانا محمد وبركاته.